Welcome to the Loyola Greyhound Podcast. I'm Jason Johnson, the Director of Video Production for Loyola Athletics. Join us as our guests will range from coaches, trainers, athletic administrators, and student athletes.
On this episode, I am joined by cross-country and track standout Senna Ohlsson. The senior Greyhound broke out in her sophomore year when she became the first Loyola runner to win a Patriot League title as she won the 800 at both the indoor and outdoor championships. Not to be outdone in her junior year, Senna notched Loyola's first ever ECAC indoor track and field title, winning the 800 in a school record time. And she also successfully defended her Patriot League indoor 800 crown. She was named to the National All-Patriot League first team and earned All-Academic Patriot League honors. This offseason, Senna decided to train in Sweden, where she won a bronze at the Swedish Championships. She talks about what contributed to her breakout year, how Loyola has helped her grow as an athlete and individual, and what training in another country during the COVID pandemic is like. So here we go with Senna Ohlsson.
Presented by the Pinnacle Advisor Group. Before we get into kind of your accomplishments here at Loyola and what kind of took you to that next level, tell me a little bit about where you grew up and how running and track and cross country and long distance running specifically, how that kind of came to be for you.
Sure. So when I was 7 years old, my family made the move from the Adirondack Mountains to a suburb outside of Philadelphia. So I spent most of my adolescent life in Ridley Park. I went to public school, and in middle school, we were offered sports for the first time, and I needed something to burn a little bit of my energy. So I joined volleyball, actually, and was pretty terrible, but every day we would do a mile warm-up as middle schoolers. Kind of sounds like a lot now to me, but and me and this one girl, Haley, would always sort of kill the mile warm-up, and she did track, and she really encouraged me to join in the spring. So I did, because I was like, well, Haley's nice and she's cool and she's sort of suggesting this to me. And I had a lot of success with it in middle school even, and sort of just stuck with it from there. In middle school and high school, I was juggling theater and track for a little while, and then ultimately just made that decision to sort of focus on athletics.
What was it that drove you to say, okay, I want to do this at the next level? So you found an enjoyment, you enjoyed the competitiveness of it in high school, but at what point did it click, like, I could do this at the collegiate level?
Yeah, I really didn't make that decision for a long time. I don't think I really thought about it. I'm not the kind of person that plans ahead very far into the future. And it kind of came to the point my junior year of high school, actually, because I graduated a year early, but I was applying to colleges in January. So I was super late into the process, and I sort of couldn't see myself not running in college. And so I guess the decision was just made of like, well, I can't imagine not doing this. So that means I'm doing it.
And when did you first talk with head coach Amy Horst, and when did you have that recruiting process, and ultimately, why did you choose Loyola?
Yeah. So like I said, I was super late into the whole college search process, in part because I didn't know before January that I was graduating a year early. And for some reason, I just decided to look into schools in Baltimore. I don't know where that idea came from either. Again, not really a planner, but I was like, Baltimore, let's see what schools are there. And Loyola seemed like the thing that I thought was most interesting here. So it's one of the schools that I applied to. I filled out a recruitment form, and I actually do remember the first phone call that I got from Amy. We played phone tag for a few weeks, so it was like back and forth, me leaving her a message, her leaving me one. And I do remember thinking like, wow, this coach seems super bubbly and nice. I had previously only had male coaches, and I actually really looked for a female coach for it, the whatever school I ran. I really hoped to have a female coach and a female role model. So most of the schools that I was seriously considering did actually have that female representation, but it's not super common in the world of track and field to find that, especially at the collegiate level. And then when I actually came to Loyola and met Amy and the team, I mean, of course there were a lot of pieces that needed to fall into place, but I was like, yeah, this is what I'm looking for.
That's awesome. That's awesome that Loyola was able to provide that for you and others. And, you know, when you were in Pennsylvania in high school, you were 14th in the 800 meters, which is not by any means a bad placement, but the major success you've had now that you're here at Loyola, what coming here, what clicked? What gave you the little extra juice in the shoes to get you going a little faster?
So I would say it's a combination of so many things. I think for a long time, I personally considered myself like a potential athlete, and I kind of like enjoyed, but also really hated that about myself. Like I felt like I was always told by people around me that I had like potential to have success, but never really quite reached that level of success that people thought I was capable of. And when I looked again into colleges, I really wanted a coach that not only believed in the success that I could reach, but believed more in me as a person. And a lot of other coaches that I actually spoke with were like, okay, this is what we think you can do as an athlete, and we want you to hit that by your junior year. And I appreciated the encouragement and the fact that they believed in me, but I wanted someone who not only saw me as an athlete, but also as an individual. And I really found that in Amy and the program that we have at Loyola. So, I mean, one of our like biggest sort of training ideas that we implement and really push forward is the idea of always being at 99% rather than ever crossing over to that 101%. So we really don't want to like have any athletes break down. And so my freshman year, I was super, super low mileage, cross-trained all the time. And, you know, I really think that it took that year of adjustment to really sort of actually benefit me sophomore year. So that sophomore year, I was able to really get like a little bit of a tougher training regimen in and then actually have success. But I don't think I would have been capable of having that without that foundation year. I was battling like anemia for a really long time, was taking supplements for a few years and just like never could get my iron values up, and finally figured that out sophomore year. So I think that's a piece of it clicking. And there's also the other aspect of it was that I was 17 competing in the Patriot League my entire freshman year, because I did graduate high school a year early. And so I think that the combination of that consistency, that sort of care of the whole person over the long period of time, and just all the pieces falling into place really propelled me forward.
Well, that propulsion forward that we're talking about led you as a sophomore, you won the Patriot League in indoor and outdoor titles. You were dominant once again in 2020, winning the Patriot League title. And then you made the decision to go train in Sweden. During your junior year of high school, you lived and trained in Sweden. So tell me about that process of and what was offered there and how you what you learned there, how you were able to bring it here and apply it there.
Sure. So everything that I brought, everything that I took with me to Sweden was sort of from my foundation at Loyola. And I mean, so again, the whole idea of going to Sweden was not planned. I'm clearly not a planner. The COVID happened, our track season got canceled. I had a summer job about 2 weeks before that summer job was supposed to start, it got canceled. And my coach in Sweden, who I've still had like very sort of loose contact with over the years, contacted me and asked if I wanted to go there and run for the summer. He was like, he made it very clear that they weren't sure what kind of season they were having since a couple meets had been canceled there as well. But I mean, the opportunity was there. I have family there. I have dual citizenship. And I was kind of, I've been considering for a long time going back, whether it's for just to compete or to take a language course or to spend time with my family. And well, when nothing else seemed to work out in America, I was like, yeah, sure, why not? I'll go to Sweden for the summer and at least get some good training in with a few other people. And it did happen that by the end of July, they were able to host a few meets. And I did find a lot of success this summer being there, but it was totally not expected or planned. And I mean, the only thing that I can really like thank almost is that consistency, that base that I was talking about. And a lot of that has come from Amy's training over the years. When I went to Sweden, the goal that I had was just to like not drastically change anything, but just get a few solid months of training in and some experience competing abroad, because I expected that it would be different, and it was completely different. But
what led you to decide while you're over there to run in the Swedish Championships?
Well, at the end of July, I raced, and I did actually impress myself a little bit. I don't really love saying that, but I ran a high 208, and my personal best from the previous outdoor season, my sophomore year, had been a mid 208. And I really didn't have a ton of training going into it this summer because COVID happened and like training was kind of inconsistent. So I was very curious to see, like, if I kept on racing and training, what opportunities would really present themselves. Also, my coach there encouraged me to run at the Swedish National Championships. Amy was super on board with the idea. But yeah, the goal was just to have the opportunity of racing and also hopefully gain some experience from a tactile championship race environment.
Well, you did very well in it, finishing third and winning bronze, which is a great accomplishment. And you're just starting to rack these up now. Do you feel like you're in a groove where, like, you are saying to yourself, well, all right, I can consistently finish at a high level with the competition that I'm currently against right now?
No, if it's a groove, then I don't know that I'm in it. I think every okay. race is difficult. Like, there, you never really, or at least I haven't gotten to a point in athletics where you sort of walk into a race and you're like, yeah, I got this. Like, no, everything is always a question. You never know what other people are going to put forward. You never know really where your body's at. I mean, even though I had success this year at the Swedish Championships, a week before that, I felt terrible and I had an awful workout. And I was like, okay, I can't really break 28 seconds in a 200 right now during a workout or a race or anything, which is like not a lot of foot speed. So I guess we'll see what a week from now brings. So I don't know if I really believe that there's a groove of like a certain point in your life that you just have this confidence that everything's going to work out. Like maybe some people do, and I admire that, but I haven't found it yet.
When you were in Sweden, that's, and we have the COVID outbreak going on, that's a country where the COVID precautions, they're not as stingy, as over here. What are the differences that you've seen being over in a country like Sweden with here? And has that affected at all your training or like you running in the championships and how you expect to run in certain competitions over here?
So Sweden took a very different approach to responding to the coronavirus crisis. And I don't know exactly like what decisions were made that they decided to sort of keep everything open there. But yeah, so we were able to hold competitions, which for a long time wasn't happening in the States. They did actually end up having races for professional athletes this summer, but it was later in the summer. But restaurants in Sweden were limited capacity, but not closed by any means. And people weren't wearing masks anywhere. So it was a very different experience. And I'm actually thankful that I had that exposure to something so different than what we're experiencing here in America, simply because I know that I will never like forget that. And it's almost like an educational piece to really understand how another country is handling COVID. But we were able to train as a team. We were able to interact with people and totally recognize that that is by no means a strategy that the United States is able to implement right now.
Right. And you feel comfortable with how Loyola is handling our current situation. Like you said, the team workouts, when I've been to a couple of the workouts and trainings of different teams, yours included, and you have your pods and you're staying 6 feet apart, socially distanced, wearing masks, even when doing your workouts and your lifts. At first, when you're working out with a mask on, it must be annoying, but have you kind of gotten used to it now, or is everybody kind of on board with your teammates and with Loyola being like, this is how it is, but we're just going to push through it? What has that been like?
Yeah, I mean, all of us, I think, are just super thankful for the opportunity to be able to practice as a group. And I mean, we're in sort of segmented groups right now, but it's still just the ability to go and work with other people makes the work feel so much simpler and easier and manageable, and really just keeps us on track with a real training regimen. I mean, lifting with the mask on is sweaty and at times a little suffocating, but it's what we need to do to keep everyone safe. And I think everyone is on board with sticking to that. And we actually have sort of expanded our opportunities as of this week, where we're able to do our workouts with our workout pod buddies as well. So that's super great going forward. And I look forward to that opportunity as well.
So I have a question about actually long distance running when you're actually doing that. A lot of people, when they just go out, they go on their normal jogs like myself and whatnot. I listen to music. You don't have the ability when you're in these long distance races to have your AirPods in or headphones on when running. So what is going through your mind during these, when you don't have music that's playing? If I'm not saying music is something that you even respond to well, but what are you contemplating? What are you thinking about? Because that's a long time to be doing one specific thing and to stay focused on whatever it is that you need, that you're focusing on in that particular race.
You know, I have wanted to ask long distance runners this question for the longest time. I'm fortunate enough to not really have to run for longer than like 2 minutes and some change. And in those 2 minutes, I think people, feet, line, track, finish, pain, like one word, simple lines. I can't imagine for the people that are like true long distance runners and have to run for 10 minutes or more. That I think is like a lot of self-encouragement that you need to have. But yeah, I mean, in my races, I do consider myself more of that like middle distance athlete than long distance. And if there's music playing during a race, I don't hear it. If someone's cheering, I don't hear it. So, I mean.
You're very focused in, right? And locked in on your cadences that you have. Pain being one of them.
Sometimes I think I fall asleep during races. Like, I don't know what happens, but.
Senna, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us about this. We're so happy and proud of you as a Greyhound and representing us well on the track and in other countries and internationally. It's very exciting to hear about what you're doing, and we're super excited about what you have in this senior year upcoming, and we can't wait to watch.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
This podcast was brought to you by the Pinnacle Advisory Group, which offers clients active investment management and in-depth financial planning to help them achieve the financial peace of mind that they have earned. Pinnacle Advisory Group is located in Maryland, where it has operated for more than 25 years. Call 410-995-6630 to speak with a certified wealth manager today. What was your favorite part you played in theater?
I don't know about role, but I could tell you my favorite show that I was a part in was Legally Blonde. We did it my freshman year. And I mean, the movie's enjoyable, but the show is just a riot.